Okay, so thanks to Kaylin and to Peter and everybody at the Strand bookstore for coming tonight. And I'm so excited to celebrate my student Judy Batalion's debut memoir, White Walls. And first, I just want to say that I love the Strand bookstore, and there's so few independent, fantastic bookstores still around. So everybody, please buy books at the Strand. You're in the most amazing place in the world, the rare books you could find. Just, I once got a first edition Great Gatsby for an amazing price here. I spend more here than I do on like shoes and clothes put together, and it's just a fantastic place. And you're not allowed, none of my students are ever allowed to buy books on Amazon. You're only allowed to buy books in places like this where you could do readings, or there won't be any more places to do readings. Okay, so thank you for Strand, by the way. And they have great tchotchkes downstairs. They have like umbrellas and notebooks and cards and magazines, so buy all your stuff at the Strand. Okay, so I'm going to introduce this really exciting panel. And when Judy told me that her new book was coming out and we figured out the date, it would be our first event of 2016, we were trying to figure out the most exciting friends and luminary editors and agents we can invite. So I'll start on the end and introduce everybody. So all the way to the left is Lauren Mechling, who is Judy's editor at Vogue magazine. And Lauren has written six young adult novels herself, including The Rise and Fall of a 10th Grade Social Climber and Dream Life. She's also written for the New York Times, New York Magazine, and the Wall Street Journal, where she was a features editor for 7 years. And she actually came to my class and helped my class out and told them all about the Wall Street Journal at the New School. So I was thrilled to have her here. And next to her is Wayne Hoffman, who is Judy's editor at Tablet, which is not only a fantastic online magazine, they just did something insane, and in the year 2015, they just launched a print edition of a Tablet, so congratulations. It's gorgeous. And Wayne is not only he's not only an executive editor at Tablet, he's the author of three novels himself, Hard, An Older Man, and Sweet Light Sugar, which won the Stonewall Book Award. He's edited many anthologies, including What We Brought Back and Policing Public Sex, and his short stories and essays were in the Best Gay Stories 2010. He has also written for the Washington Post, The Nation, and The Advocate, and we're thrilled to have him. And next to him is Alia, Hanna, Habib, who's Judy's literary agent, who sold Judy's book to Penguin Random House. Yay!
It's a great one.
Fantastic. Very excited. Best, biggest publisher in the world. And Alia lives in Brooklyn, and she works at McCormick Literary. She was previously a book publicist at Houghton Mifflin Harcourt. Her clients also include Dori Scheffer, Ophira Eisenberg, Elizabeth Green, and she was recently featured in Poets and Writers as a hot young agent. Judy sent me the piece. And next to her is Frank Flaherty, who was a New York Times editor for 20 years, where he used to come speak to my classes and bought many, many pieces for my students, some of whom the first clip they ever got was the New York Times, so he has amazing amounts of good publishing karma. And he's also the author of his own book called The Elements of Story, which is a writing guide published by HarperCollins. He is now teaching at Columbia and NYU, and he has a new class coming up called The Art of the Pitch at NYU's School of Professional Studies that anybody could take starting March 10th. Rakia Clark next to me is a senior editor at Beacon Press, and I know about Beacon Press aside from reading great poetry books and books by women from them. One of my former students, Daisy Hernandez, had an award-winning book called A Cup of Water Under the Bridge, which won a Lambda Literary Award last year. Under the bed, cup of water under the bed. And Rakia has worked as an editor, ghostwriter, researcher, and writing coach at HarperCollins, Viking, and Kensington Publishing. She's done books by Bill Cosby, Bush political advisor Karen Hughes, historian Joseph Campbell, we can ask her about it later, and WNBA legend Lisa Leslie. She's been an adjunct lecturer at City College, and she lives in Harlem. And she has worked at SAT Prep and Upward Bound, an after-school program for disadvantaged teens. Just excited to have her here. Next to me is Peter Catapano, who's also an editor at the New York Times. He's now at the opinion page, where he's been since 2005. And also, he's bought tons of pieces by my students when they were doing the great section Anxiety and Menagerie. And he also does Home Fires and they also do in that section op-eds, private lives, couch, and really the most exciting, maybe the most exciting what do you call them, subdivision of The Opinionator has been Stone, where he's published fantastic pieces of philosophy that are now collected in the Stone Reader, which just came out. So I was so excited that he could join us right as his book is coming out. And all the way at the end is Judy Batalion, who's my former New School student. I actually went through my old emails, and she took my class in 2010, and she was working on the book even then. So it's 6 years before her victorious publication, and she's written for The Forward Tablet, The Washington Post Salon, and the New York Times Motherlode, where she launched her book. And she grew up in Montreal and lives in Chelsea with her husband and two daughters. And Zelda is actually in the audience. Hi, Zelda. He's watching her mommy. You're in trouble. She's going to be a writer now. Okay, so why don't we just jump in? I'm going to ask some questions, and then you guys will have a chance to ask any questions that you want. So, Judy.
Hi.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
How's
Thank
it feel?
Thank you, everyone, for coming.
It feels.
Oh, yes.
Much better.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you, everyone, for coming.
So you launched your book with a New York Times Motherlode. And I love starting. A lot of my students, writing students at NYU and the New School, come to me and they want to do a book, and they're already overwhelmed at the thought of 300 pages, and they just don't know how to do it. And I always say, 2 pages can change your life, or 3 pages can change your life. And you're a perfect example, because it seems as if the Motherlode piece that you did about having a mother that was a hoarder was kind of the launch of your book. So could you tell us a little bit about that? And if I remember correctly, there's a bunch of different places in the New York Times and other newspapers and magazines like Tablet and Vogue where you could just do a short essay. So I'm under the impression you wrote the whole piece, right?
The piece for Motherlode, yes, I managed to. I should probably say, for people that don't know about the book, it's really a generational mother-daughter story about sort of overcoming my dysfunctional childhood in order to try to become a functional parent myself, or try is the word. My mother was a severe hoarder, and the way I dealt with that was by doing a 180 and becoming a militant minimalist. If my family was a Yiddishy hot mess, I was going to be an aloof art curator in England, no less. I made a white-walled home with literally just two white sofas, and then the positive pregnancy test. Having a daughter myself turned things around. I couldn't maintain those white sofas anymore. So I managed to write that story about sort of coming to terms with the mess of motherhood in 785 words that I sent to Motherlode. And I wrote that essay while I was working on the proposal for the book, so they really fed into each other.
And if somebody's starting a book, do you agree that a great way to launch it sometimes is with a short essay?
Yes, I am. In fact, a year before that, I wrote another piece about my mother's hoarding and how it affected me in terms of my intimacy issues in Salon. And that got a lot of attention right away. So I publish a lot of essays, but I noticed certain ones got attention. So it made me realize, oh, there's a book in there. There's rich material in there.
Fantastic. And Peter, actually, a lot of my students have launched books in the New York Times and the New York Times Opinionator section. How do you come up with, because they have all these different ideas, like Couch is about shrinks and Stone is about philosophy, and you had Townies. And when he was doing anxiety, he came to speak to my class, and every single student said, this is the least anxious person we've ever met. How did he come up with the idea of anxiety? So how do you guys come up with the ideas?
Technically, it does happen the way you think it would happen, which would be a group of my colleagues sitting around in an idea meeting. But the ideas really, at least for me, germinate on a longer time frame, and usually have to do with my own obsessions at the time. When I thought about anxiety and how I was dealing with my own anxiety, I saw that there was a lot of potential for other people to weigh in on it. But usually I would just go to meetings that with ideas that reflected what it was I was interested in, and just luckily the few ideas that I've executed there have been of interest to other people.
Are you interested in philosophy?
I am. I was not a philosophy major in college, but once I started really editing at the Times, I found that the articles that I edited that had some philosophical content that was sort of memoir but had philosophical background. I just enjoyed them. I really dug into them. I thought they were more satisfying than a typical op-ed. And so I just kind of kept going with it until Simon Critchley and I, Simon's a professor at the New School as well, and a very prolific and brilliant philosopher and writer. We started working together on another series. I liked working with his pieces. We got along, and we just started talking about, you know, other people in the field who could really do a great job with this, and we pursued it from that.
And what astounds me, and maybe you can help me for the people that are my students here, new people, it sort of astounds me how many students of mine like have gotten their first clip in the New York Times, and it seems as if the ticket or the trick really is, the secret, is write a brilliant 2 or 3 page essay, you know, and now they have the op-ed page, Couch is about therapy, Private Lives is about, you know, something going on in your own life, you did Menagerie. So from an editor's standpoint, I would guess that if somebody pitches you, you might want to know their background, and they might need a platform, and why should we give them an assignment? But if they write an entire 3-page essay and you read the whole thing and it's great, are you more likely to say yes to that?
Yeah, it's because of the pace that we have to work at. Aside from what I do, all my colleagues get dozens of pitches a day. We really have to look at finished pieces, and if not finished, they have to be realized to the point where at least you can get a sense of what it's going to be after one more revision. So that's sort of essential, but that very much has to do with our business, not necessarily the book business. But yeah, seeing the whole thing and being able to see how it would look once it was published is kind of mandatory, yeah.
Great, and Rakia, actually, I remember that my student who did the Daisy Hernandez, who did a cup of water under my bed, she actually started, I remember, with a short piece in Ms. Magazine. So as a book editor, do you ever see pieces that are published and think, oh, this is an interesting author, maybe I should see if they have anything longer?
Sure, but sometimes I don't even wait for that. You know, I'm on Twitter, I'm on Facebook, and people publish really pithy things there and smart things there. And so if I'm following someone and I notice that they're constantly responding to things in a way that I think that I like, I may reach out to them and we'll have coffee, and then I'll just say, you know, do you have some ideas? What are you thinking about? And then we can take things from there. So at Beacon Press, we're a small independent press, and so oftentimes I'm working with authors who don't have a literary agent. Sometimes they do, but oftentimes I'm working with people who are really bright and really smart, but aren't at the place where they're getting essays published, but where they could. They just don't know how to do that yet, and so I can develop something with them before they even get to that point.
And if you don't mind, just for people that might not know or might be working on books, I'm under the impression that, and we'll ask some of the novelists down there to help us out with this, I'm under the impression that with a novel, you have to write the whole thing. But if you're writing a nonfiction book, some of my memoirs, I've written the whole thing, but sometimes you can just write a proposal.
Usually we're going on a proposal. That's what I, when we get to the point where there's a proposal, I can buy that, but it can take months. So I signed up something today, for example, but I've been working with the author on this since last June.
So, and a proposal could be usually anywhere from 20 to 120 pages, right?
Sure, but shorter is better.
Shorter is better. Okay, and if you don't mind, I've been told that for a good nonfiction proposal, I've been told you need title, subtitle, overview of what the book is about, sample chapters, which is usually the first maybe 2 chapters, and then a chapter breakdown, a tiny bit about what your platform is, what your background is, and then also comparable titles. So is that sort of like a standard nonfiction proposal, right?
Yep.
Fantastic. Great. Okay, Frank, I know that some of my students have taken your classes, and I know that Frank actually also used to buy a lot of great essays that my students wrote for the New York Times. And a couple of my students, even though your class is called How to Pitch, a couple of my students who took your class said that one of the things you talk about is how even if you write an entire essay, having a title and a subtitle and a way to describe it really well in a letter to an editor is important. And could you talk a little bit about that? Because of course, you know, if you want to get on contract for a long profile or a investigative piece, I knew you had to do a pitch, but I thought it was kind of brilliant to think of, even when you're writing an essay, you should think of a sexy title, a sexy subtitle, a interesting way to describe it in really short form so that editors could see what you're doing right away?
Right, and it's not just the title and the subtitle and making it snappy, it's more about the idea. I mean, the main thing I think about pitches is 85 to 90% of the value of the pitch is sharpening the concept for the essay, saying why it's different, what's unique about it, and framing it, thinking about how to phrase it is critical in learning how to think about it yourself. So there's a lot of the work that goes into writing a pitch is not just salesmanship, it's actually part of the writing. And that I think is critical, and you can even, I know writers who have sort of written pitches or quasi pitches even though they knew they were going to have it published somewhere, just as a way of like sharpening what the value, you know, of the piece was and what made it fresh.
And when you teach your course, do you talk about that? Do you talk about, like, you know, aside from writing the whole story, do you talk about how to pitch it well and how to make it clear in a short amount of time how much, you know, what you're going to be doing to the editor?
Yeah, it's about being fresh and concise, just like writing is about being fresh and concise. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And when you did your book, The Elements of Story, how long was your proposal, if you don't mind me asking?
I think it was about 10,000 words, all totaled. It's a 54-book chapter, and the chapters are really short. And I think we included maybe a dozen of them in there. But you didn't really have to read all of them to get the gist of the proposal. But we did. But you could sort of take it or leave it. We kind of knew that an agent or an editor wouldn't have to be in for a dime and for a dollar, so that it wouldn't have to read all 10,000 words.
And was it fun to go from, you were an editor for 20 years, to go also like Peter to edit other people's work and then to have your own book? Was that exciting?
It was exciting. I had a great time you know, doing it, and it's about editing, so it's sort of like reviewing and reliving the stuff that I did, you know, as an editor.
Great. And Alia, so in your career you've done fiction and nonfiction, even though now you said you're doing more nonfiction. And do you agree from a literary agent standpoint that if you want to write a novel, if it's your first book, you'd probably have to write the whole thing, but if it's nonfiction, you could write a proposal?
Yeah, I'd say that is 75% the case, that the proposal really, I don't think we've ever, in my office, very rarely sell nonfiction with a full. Recently, I sold a novel with a partial, and I remember, I mean, the process of doing it, you're aware while you're doing it that it's the exception, not the rule, and it was a case where the author was already well known, well established, had a platform, and you know, if you're selling a partial, you have to be a known quantity, especially for fiction.
And actually, I saw in your Poets and Writers interview, you actually talked about how sometimes you'll see an article or an essay, and that'll make you interested in the person. Could you talk about that?
Right, exactly. I mean, everything you were saying earlier about, I have a book idea. I would say if you have a book idea, this is counterintuitive advice and not very writerly advice, but like, don't like hole yourself up for 5 years and write your book and come back and expect somebody to publish it. If you can't write a 1,000-word essay, it might actually be very hard for you to write your book. And often the way that, and I'm not the only agent like this, the way that I find clients is I read something in the New York Times and track them down or follow them on Twitter and find out about them. And I think I'm not a genius for figuring that out. That's the way most of us do it now. So that is a way to get your work out there. And it shows us, it shows me as an agent, shows publishers that you can write concisely, you can do the grunt work of getting your stuff out there, you can pitch yourself, and that's a lot of what we're looking for.
Yeah, it's a great test. I know my physical therapist, Kenan, was a Bosnian war survivor, and when I told him to write about it, he thought I was crazy, and he wound up with his first piece that he'd ever written in his life was wound up in the New York Times Lives column, the best American essays, had agents and editors calling him wanting the book, and he would have never thought to write a book had he not had that kind of interest.
Yeah, and I would guess that being a Bosnian war survivor is harder than writing the essays, if you can do. But I think if you told him to go off and write the book, you would never have the book.
Oh, no,
you
he thought I was. Yeah, no. Right, in fact, I said write a book, and he thought I was crazy.
Right.
And that actually happened with another student of mine, Aspen Matus. One Modern Love column, the vice president of HarperCollins, Lisa Sharkey, called her and said, "I want this book from 1,500 words."
It happens. It happens all the time. And part of my job as an agent, and I'm sure it's the same thing with editors, is sometimes you read an essay, and I do this all the time, where I read the essay, and I think maybe the author doesn't see what the book is, but a good agent or a good editor will, and that's part of the conversation, is you look at it and you're like, oh, it can go this way, you can pull it that way, and you talk to them and you figure it out. So it's kind of like the essay is a kind of bat signal that you get out there, and really, especially now in the age of the internet, I can find anyone. You know, if they publish something, I can find them. Or my husband can, because he's better at the kind of digging around on the internet. And then if it is good and it gets out there, eventually I think that people will come and find you.
Great. And Wayne, aside from writing his own books, has come to speak to my classes and has bought Judy and a bunch of my other students' essays. So could you talk about, you have a double life too, because you write books. You write books and you have full-time editing, Jeff.
Yes. Oh, yes. Is that a double life or is that two half-lives?
You tell me.
Yeah, double life, definitely.
Okay. And did you start out as a writer? And then
I started out as a journalist when I was 18, which is actually a long time ago. You'll be surprised to learn. And I went from being a journalist to being a journalistic editor, and went from that to being an essay writer, and from that I somehow woke up one day in southern Mexico and became a novel writer by accident, and it's been both ever since, because I realized that they sort of fulfill different halves of my brain.
And do you agree that for a novel you usually write the whole book?
Yeah, you gotta write the whole book. You have to. And it's actually, to go back to what someone else brought up earlier about writing essays, sometimes with a personal essay, you also need to write the whole thing. And the reason is similar. It's because if someone's pitching me a reported piece, I can walk them through the reporting. And as long as they've done the interviews and have the facts, I can help shape that piece if it hasn't come in great. I can't help you write your personal story myself. I need you to be able to express it. And if you can't express it lyrically, it's never going to work no matter what I do. And it's the same with a novel. If you had a novel that had interesting ideas in it but wasn't well written, it's never going to work. So the ideas aren't enough to sell a novel. Sometimes you can sell nonfiction on the ideas, but you can't do that with a novel. It doesn't work.
Great. And Lauren, you also work as an editor at Vogue, and you're at Wall Street Journal, and you've written several novels. So did you start out writing and then get to go to editing?
I've sort of started out doing both at the same time.
Could you talk into the mic?
Oh, I can't hear you. Sorry. I started out pretty much doing both at the same time. I was writing novels. I guess I was a very, very, very young journalist, and I was writing novels before I went to work in the morning. And now I'm pretty much always working as an editor and journalist, and sort of living out my missing being a novelist by really, really collaborating with my writers and sometimes driving them crazy with my ideas of how something should go. But
so you find it, if you're working full-time as an editor, it's hard to write also?
Well, I believe you can do two things, and I have two small children, so I do that as well as I can, and I work really hard at my job. And
what kind of pieces do you do for Vogue? I know Judy said that she had a piece that was
yes, she has a great piece. Have you seen it?
No, tell us. I haven't seen it. Tell us about it.
So Judy's piece, I will say, Judy's piece is pretty much emblematic of the kinds of pieces that I am mostly doing. So my main job at Vogue is to be the health and fitness editor, but our challenge in the print magazine right now is to figure out a way to make our stories worthwhile when we have, you know, Vogue.com is just doing amazing work and they're posting stories the next morning. And so for me, my secret weapon has been taking advantage of my love of literature and writing and finding voices that I just know are gonna survive. So when we close an issue and it doesn't come out on the newsstands until 2 months later, and then the magazine stays on someone's coffee table for a full month, that it's still gonna be super delicious. So anyway, so Judy, I had read her book and it kind of clicked with an idea I just kept hearing about. I can say it now because it's going to be out there. So, you know, the Marie Kondo hyper, you know, crazy cleaning, and I was just thinking, how can we approach this as a health story? This is this insane cultural craze. Everyone's just purging everything, and then Judy wrote this amazing story about, you know, growing up in a household where purging was the opposite of what anyone believed in. So we worked together to sort of form this double helix of her personal story and this cultural moment right now.
Great, and you mentioned Vogue.com, and I think a lot of my students are finding that if it's hard to get into a print magazine like Vogue or Elle magazine or Cosmo, that it's much easier to get into the online version. So are there separate editors? Or like if somebody sent you a piece that didn't work for you but might work for Vogue.com, would you ever send it along yourself, or do they have to know how to do that?
It's a separate magazine. It's a separate team. I wouldn't say it's easier, but I would say they have a different, you know, sensibility and metabolism, and I think that's true of a lot of print and digital components of a print magazine. So they're, you know, a lot of the times I get ideas that I think are fantastic, but I just know aren't as much in step with what Vogue is pursuing, and I will, you know, share it with a colleague on another floor.
Great. Okay, so now I want to talk about mistakes that people make, because I not only got many years of rejections myself, but I know with students of mine, I definitely have students that email me and say, great class, I'm halfway through the novel already, I'm sending it to you right now. And it's like, wait, I saw you a week ago. But anyway, so meaning that they think they've written a novel from one class to the next. But anyway, so Judy, so what kind of mistakes would you say that you made when you were working on your project? I think I remember it took a while to find the exact theme, because you were writing about stand-up and being in London and working in a museum. Did it take a while of like writing essays or writing pages before you came to the exact theme of your book?
Oh, mistakes. I mean, I'm not sure that was mistakes. I think that was just the process of figuring out what the book was. I'd been writing, I'd done stand-up for a while, and I'd written a lot of personal essays. So I had all this material about me, but how was I going to make a book? So I went through many different, even though the themes were the same, mother-daughter relationships, the search for home, our relationship to objects and to space, I consistently wrote about those themes. But it was, as we were saying before, that piece for Salon and the piece in Motherlode that I saw, they seem to resonate with a lot of people. And so I started to see, oh, this is where the book lies. There's something in this hoarding story, in my reaction to hoarding, in my emotional baggage that my mother's hoarding passed to me. And then I had a baby, and that gave me a structure for the book. I had a very complicated relationship with my mother, and suddenly I had a daughter. And that was such a nice moment of, gave the book an impetus and a genuine struggle. I really wanted to understand how not to repeat the same dynamics I had with my mother, with my daughter.
So, and also, I know that you took classes and you did a writing group and you used ghost editors. So is there anything in particular, did the whole process help you? Was there anything in particular? Because some people say, like, if you take a writing class, you know, for 10 or 15 weeks, then you have a deadline where you have to, you know, and you have colleagues. Or if you pay a ghost editor, which we're going to talk about, that you could actually work with a professional who could help you kick your pages into shape. So is there anything in particular that really helped you?
I only write with external deadlines. I cannot write without an external deadline, even if that deadline is that my friend is going to read it at 4:00 next Wednesday, even if she doesn't read it, but that I know I'm going to email it to her. So I can't write without that.
So classes and workshops
classes
are good.
And workshops are what make me do it. Yeah, great. I write under pressure.
Great. And Peter, maybe you could tell us, because I'm sure everybody wants to get in the New York Times, what kind of mistakes do people make when they're sending stuff to the New York Times? I have a joke in my class about, like, letters editors never finished reading. So it's like, though I've never read your section, or though I've never been published at all in my whole life before. So what?
That actually isn't.
That's not bad for you?
No, not at all.
Okay,
it's so more exciting to publish someone
the
first time.
So what kind of mistakes do you see that people do when they're sending stuff to the New York Times for you?
probably everybody who works in journalism or has any experience with this knows, double submissions can be a problem. We don't like them because we sometimes invest a lot of energy into saying yes to a piece and starting to produce it and get it ready, and then see it on Salon or the Washington Post, and that is definitely something
so
that
no
angers.
Multiple submissions. If you're going to send a piece out, send it to one editor and then follow up a week or 2 weeks later, give them a chance to say yes or no. Don't multiple submit. It's different with literary agents, but when you're most editors that I've worked with in newspaper magazines, you only send it to one place. That's a great one. Anything else?
Well, there's sort of the process of follow-up that happens. A lot of times pieces come in and we can't get to them right away, so people will write back, check in a week or two later, and you know, that's generally fine. A lot of times we have to say no because we get so many submissions. Saying no is a big unpleasant part of the job. And every now and then a writer will write back and ask, can you tell me why? And I find that really difficult on a few levels. One is that we don't have time to sort of do that kind of coaching or analysis. It's just not possible. And the second is we really need to maintain an aura and a process that has courtesy in it, because you're dealing with other people all the time, and other people have feelings, and I have feelings. And so we like to keep it on that level. If I don't like a piece, or I think it's poorly done or insignificant, I don't want to have to think about drafting a note to a person I don't know, telling them that. Besides for the time factor, it's just sort of breaks the code. Whatever the code may be. So.
And also, like, a lot of my students will, a lot of editors have told me that students will send a piece on Tuesday and Wednesday morning will phone the editor and say, did you read it yet? Did you read it yet? So a metaphor that one of the editors uses, pretend it's dating. So be really cool, you know, so send it in and then go away. And also, if the person says no, don't say, what about this? What about this? What about that? You know, because if you ask someone out, do you want to go out Saturday night? And they say no, you wouldn't say, do you want to go out Sunday night? Want to go out Monday night? Want to go out Tuesday? So probably, wait a week or two if you send a piece before you follow up, and be very, and only by email, right? You don't want phone calls from people you don't know.
Yeah, generally not. There's no real formula. Sometimes somebody's third or fourth piece will work. So I don't think I want to discourage that, but you know, you have to use your sensibilities, like the same way you would in a room of people. Editing and emailing and communicating with others is really like a social situation. And so whatever you think you might do in a social situation is probably a good guideline for how you would deal with an editor.
I asked an editor, how should I tell my students to deal with it? He said, tell them, don't be crazy. Rakia, let's talk about some mistakes that people make with nonfiction books. I always get students that say, okay, I have this great idea and it's about how I quit drinking. Here. And I feel like, okay, go to the library or Google, and it's not that you can't do that book, it's just you have to understand that that book has been written 10,000 times, so what are you adding to it, or is there something new or different? So do you get that sometimes when people are pitching you ideas?
Yes. Yes, absolutely. My first pet peeve is that people don't use Google enough. They use me, come to me for Google. And so sometimes I'll get an email and they'll say, well, what kind of books do you all publish? And like, go to our website, you can see what kind of books we publish. Or they have a half-baked idea that, as you say, has been published a billion times over, done way, way better than this person's skill set. So the amount of research is really important. Even if you're coming to me with just the kernel of an idea, just the seed of it, that's okay. You know, for me, I don't have to have the whole thing baked. But it's got to be smart, and it's got to show that you've thought about what my publishing house does, what I've done in the past, You know, if you Google my name, something will come up. And so you'll have some history of the kind of books that I publish. And so if you come and you pitch, you know, some 50 Shades of Grey, not that there's anything wrong with that, but that's not what I work on. That's not what I publish. And so it shows a real lack of thought and care when that happens.
And you said you've worked as a ghostwriter and a writing coach. So if somebody has an idea, I would say, you know, it's not a race to get it to an agent really fast. Probably a good thing to do would be class, writing group, work with a coach before you get the material together.
I highly recommend writing groups, writing workshops, you know, find people that write a little bit better than you and write with them.
Good. Judy and I actually, I invited her into a private writing group that I do. Okay, Frank, I know that you've worked as a ghost editor, if you don't mind me talking about it, and I always tell the story of I was working on a book for 7 years and it was getting rejections and I was just like getting stoned and drunk and hiding under my bed and I was so upset and pissed off. And I remember my shrink was very big on therapy. My shrink was like, okay, maybe there's a better way to go about this and deal with rejection. And you happened to mention that you were jealous of two friends that just got book deals. One was nonfiction, one was fiction. So he was like, why don't you see if you could take them out for a drink or lunch and tell them about your project and see if they have any advice that they could give you about how they did it. So I went out with my friend Larry for lunch, and he said to me, okay, I'm going to tell you my secret. The way I sold my nonfiction proposal was I used this fantastic ghost editor named Sally, and I'm going to give you her phone number. Don't tell anybody I told you. She was a former editor at Doubleday, and she fixed it first. So I said, okay. Then I went out to dinner with Yona, who had just done a big novel, and I said, you know, do you have any advice? And she says, okay, don't tell anyone, but there's this great ghost editor that I gave my novel to, and her name is Sally, and here she is. But I contacted Sally, and it was like $2,200 because I had like 250 pages. So I went to my shrink and I said, it's too expensive. And he said, are you an asshole? Are you an idiot? You just had two people tell you that this woman, you've wasted 6.5 years. Sometimes you have to spend money to make money. You have two amazing recommendations for this ghost editor. Try it. So I tried it, and it was $2,200. And my first advance for that book from Random House was $50,000. And then I got a movie deal, a TV deal, 7 foreign rights, and it led to 9 other books. So I swear by ghost editors, and a lot of people don't talk about it, but I'm kind of proud to talk about it because I feel like nobody just sits alone and writes a book in their room. I think you need something, whether it's classes or workshops. And it turns out that after Frank Flaherty left the New York Times, he said to me that for articles and sometimes for book projects, he will sometimes take it on as an editor and work with writers on projects. So when you do that, just what kind of things are people getting wrong when they're giving you, like for example, if someone comes to you and they want you to help ghost edit an article, what are common mistakes do you see? And you know, like, are you seeing like they're not timely at all?
Well, speaking like both as a ghost editor and as a former Times editor, I would say I'm sort of picking up on what Peter said. Can you all hear me? Yeah. I'm picking up on what Peter said. You've got to like do your homework. And if you're publishing essays and articles in periodicals, study the periodical. Know the kinds of stuff they run. The ideal is that you become... you sort of empathize with the editors who run that periodical. You know the kinds of things they like, and you get to a kind of zone where you say, you know that story that I was just thinking about? That's a perfect story for The Tablet or some other magazine. Because then you're sort of, you know, mind-melding with editors, and that's what they're looking for, and that's how you learn it. There are plenty of horror stories I can give you about articles, terrific articles about New Jersey that I would get when I was the deputy editor of the New York City section, and they just don't check it out. I mean, public relations folks lose, I think, a lot of opportunities by not tailoring their pitches to the publication. But I'm talking not just about content or geography, but about tone and subject matter. And if you start thinking about those things, you know, and read the magazine you are targeting, then that pitch, the good idea, will come naturally. So the biggest mistake, I think, is not doing, you know, your homework for your target, you know, outlet.
That's great. In fact, in my classes, the first assignment I always give is write about your most humiliating secret, but before 3 double spaced type pages, but before someone even starts writing, I say to them, where are you aiming it? Because Salon is very different than the New York Times Lives column, is very different than Tablet, it's different than Vogue. So I think that's great. And if you're working as a ghost editor, if somebody hires you, do you help them with that? Could you say, you're saying the New York Times, but you have the word motherfucker 3 times, so obviously you're not paying attention to the fact that the New York Times, you can't swear. Like, will you help them figure out who their audience is?
Right. You have to figure out who your audience is, which means figuring out your content and your style, your tone, your length. even, and whether or not you use Mr. and Ms., and all those littler questions.
Great. And Alia, as a literary agent, do you think it's good that people, like Judy, maybe first took classes and then did a writing group and worked on her material before she comes to you? Or do you think if somebody has an idea that it's okay to come to you and you will help them with some of the mistakes they're making? Or does it just depend?
It varies so much from client to client, but I think by the time you get to the point where you're ready to work with an agent, and I do edit my clients, I work very closely with them, but you should be at a level of professionalization that happens through working with a community of writers. Now, I work with a lot of journalists, and that process too is a process of knowing how to be edited, knowing how to take edits, knowing how to pitch. Memoirists are a little different because often they work with writer groups, and I think that especially with memoirists and personal material, working with a community of writers is important. But in any case, your agent shouldn't be your first reader. And you have to think about a way an agent makes money. I don't make money unless I sell something. So if it comes to me in a really raw state, I'm not looking at something that is anyone else is going to want to read and buy and pay money for.
Right, so by the way, so a big mistake that people make, I think, is going to literary agents too quickly.
Like right,
your first
right,
step should
right.
be, I finished writing this, let me get it to the editor, the agent quickly. I think that you should have a system.
Right, exactly. And part of that is, no matter what genre you're writing in, a community of readers, because by the time it gets to an agent, and believe me, I edit the work closely and really think about the idea, but you are thinking, like, on some level, are people going to want to, is this at a level where people would pay money for it? And it's not going to be there if I'm the first reader, ever.
And can you talk about other mistakes people make? For example, a lot of literary agents say, if I see in the email that you've sent this to 20 people, or you've spelled
oh
my name wrong, I'm not even going to pay attention, right?
So I mean, I can't even, of course, no. I shouldn't be copied among, no.
A lot of people don't understand it, I think. And someone should Google you and know
right,
other books.
Right, yeah, exactly.
I mean, a great way, I think, to start with a literary agent is to say, you know, if you wanted Alia as your literary agent, you would say, you know, thanks so much for doing that fantastic Strand panel. I looked up the article, I looked up the article in Poets and Writers. Fantastic. I bought Judy's book, and I loved
right,
it.
Absolutely.
I know Ophira's
absolutely.
Book.
Absolutely.
Hey, it turns out I'm working on a project that's
right,
similar.
Absolutely.
Right,
absolutely. That's the number one. And I also tell people that... I think this is true of both publishing pieces and trying to find an agent. If you're thinking about where you want to get published, you should be buying those magazines or reading those magazines and supporting them with your money, but also having a sense of that world that they're trying to reach. And the same thing with books is that when you think about an agent that you want, like really think about, and you should be reading and buying books, you know, you want to look in the acknowledgments section and see, everyone says this, but it's true, who they're thanking. That's the way to think about the kind of agent you want. That you want the agent who if your favorite writer is like Kate Atkinson, you know, that's a great agent too. But like, maybe if you're looking at when I see one of my books and it's not the most famous book, but like the one that I really love that's maybe a little less famous, that's even like music to my ears that you found this book and loved it. That's a passionate and thoughtful reader, and agents love that.
Great. And Wayne, as an editor at Tablet, could you talk about some of the mistakes that would make you not want to work with somebody?
Gladly. You know, Sue, I never have to do much research because I just figure out what happened to me today, and here's a list of mistakes I got on my desk today.
Okay, good.
Most of which are frequent. Don't send me a pitch that doesn't have your name or my name on it. This happens every single day. Don't send me a pitch that's not really about a story. I got a pitch today. Someone who I've never spoken to before said, I just went to Spain and I thought I could write about it. Well, write what about it? What happened? Who are you? What's the story? What are we talking about? A reported feature, a memoir, a piece of Spanish poetry? What are we talking about? No idea. Don't do that. Timeliness. We publish Tablet every day, 5 days a week, but you have to realize I'm not a blogger who just hits publish. We're actually a magazine, and we work much more like a print magazine. So I got a pitch today at 3 p.m. on Friday, the 15th of January. Someone proposing a story that they would first begin to write about Martin Luther King. And I wrote back, I said, if you'll notice, our entire site today is about Martin Luther King, and all those pieces were in a week ago and pitched a month ago, and our last publishing day before Martin Luther King's birthday is observed is now, and the day's almost over. You're a month late. Lastly, I'd say stories that make perfectly clear that you either have no idea what kind of stories we ever run, or you have no idea that your really great idea we've already run. Again, Google. But beyond that, my three biggies, and I've said this before, and some of this is overlap, but I'll just hammer it home. My three big no's. Multiple submissions, multiple editors, multiple versions. Stop it. Multiple submissions. If you're pitching to magazines or newspapers, I'm going to explain the exception in a second. There's no really good reason, asterisk, why you should be sending a submission to more than one publication at a time. The exception is, an example, missiles are headed our way right now, and if I don't publish this piece in the next hour, we will all die. Fine, got it. Exception number two, David Bowie just died, and you were his mistress, and you know you have to publish this story somewhere in the next hour, or else every publication will already have their David Bowie story. You know that if you don't sell it today, you're never going to sell it. Fine. Those are two exceptions that come to mind. David Bowie dying, and he's already dead, so that's not valid anymore. And nuclear missiles, not just ballistic missiles, nuclear coming our way. Short of that, no multiple submissions. And if one of those situations happens, you must disclose it in your opening sentence that this is being submitted more than one place. Multiple editors, if you submit to more than one editor at a publication, it's a guarantee no one will respond to you because everyone thinks someone else is going to do it. It's on someone else's desk. It's a surefire way to get no response. Multiple versions. Once you send me a piece, step away from the computer. Stop working on it. Stop it. Because otherwise you risk what happens, and it happens at least once a month, that I've actually accepted a piece, but often, especially with a piece of memoir or first person piece, my response to say yes is not just to say, yes, print. It's to say, yes, I think your piece is interesting, and here's a rough edit. Here's what I think I would do with it. If you'd like to keep going, we'll keep going. And in the meantime, you've kept working on it, and now we have two versions of it. And now you're going to incorporate my edits into a version that I actually haven't seen. And it's a mess. It's a disaster. Don't do it. And that's not just on pitch. That's anywhere along the lines. Once you send something to your editor, you wait to hear back. Otherwise, all the wheels fall off the cart.
Great. Lauren, that was great. Yeah. Lauren, anything else that would bother you as an editor, both at the Wall Street Journal and now at Vogue, that would make you not want to work with a writer?
I'm thinking of going beyond the pitching process, because at Vogue, I work with my writers so intimately over such a long period of time that I think it's, you know, once a pitch has been approved and I've taken it on and I'm going to really support it and do everything I can to get it up the flagpole, I think it's really important, and the writers understand that we are a team together, and I'm doing everything I can to advocate for them and to help them, and that if I'm gonna, you know, I often come to writers with, I tend to accept blind pitches less frequently than I will have an idea of something I've been researching that I'm interested in, and then I have a crush on a writer voice, and I'll reach out to them and say, can we, you know, do you think there's something there? Are you interested in doing this with me? All to say, I think the process of once a piece has been green-lighted is to not have an adversarial relationship with your editor, and to understand that you can be making a beautiful thing together and many times in the future. And I will say there are some top tier writers who I've been reluctant to go to with the second assignment, and then there have been some like B++ writers who I'm so happy to assign to because I adore them, because I know that I'm going to then, for the month that we're closing our story, I'm going to be on the phone with them for an hour every day, and I look forward to that.
Yeah, actually, I had a student that they had a piece that they sent in. The editor said yes, and they felt it was butchered, and they were really upset, and they came to me screaming and crying that it's all been ruined. What should I do? So I said, okay, write a letter to the editor and say, this is what you ruined. This is what I hate. Be very specific. Everything that was butchered, why it was butchered. Show it to me. Throw it away. And then write a letter saying, thank you so much for taking the time to help me with my piece. It's such an honor to work with you. I can't wait to work with you again. Because really, you're so lucky to, I mean, a lot of the time, especially if you haven't been writing that much, but for an editor to take the time to want to make your piece great, you pretty much just assume you're going to be edited, especially if it's Vogue or Tablet or the New York Times. These are people that have been doing it for years and years. They know their voice better than you, and you just sort of have to... you have to compromise. It doesn't mean every single change that they make you have to take, but you do have to compromise. Please.
Just to hammer that home, because it's a great point about not having an adversarial relationship with your editor, but one of the other reasons beyond the apparent immediate reason not to do that is because your editor works with other editors. And as soon as a pitch comes in at a story meeting, everyone will say, I just got a pitch from Sue Shapiro. Did any of you work with her? And the person says, don't work with her. That's it. And then a year later, that editor has moved to a new publication where another 20 editors will say, did you ever get a pitch from Sue Shapiro? I did. Don't work with her. And it spreads like wildfire.
I can't tell you how many editors have said that. And they've also said...
Not true of Sue Shapiro, by the way.
Not about me, but about how many editors have said that if you're a headache, I'm just going to tell everyone. And when the New York Times calls me and says, my Tin House editor said, when my New York Times friend calls me and says, can you recommend anyone? Do you know this guy? I'm going to say no. So it is a really small world. So you don't want to be a headache, and you don't want to be adversarial, and it only benefits you, because sometimes if somebody kills your baby, but if you read it over 3 days later, it's actually made a lot better, and it's much more for that publication. So, please.
Just to follow up on what Lauren was saying, for those of you who are new at writing and haven't gotten a lot of stuff published, it may seem unlikely, but it's not that unlikely to become a regular writer, on a freelance basis for a particular editor in a particular publication. And that's another reason to be, cordial and develop that. But if you think in the long term, in the beginning you're sending out pitches, no one's responding, you're getting upset and depressed, but eventually for many people it turns around. And especially if you have a particular, I remember a freelancer we used who wrote about the harbor, the New York harbor, a lot, everything to do with water, before it was necessarily that cool to do. And in the beginning he would send us pitches, we'd reject them, then we'd take a story or two, and then eventually the connection was made. And if a news story drove up or swam up about water, we'd say, let's call Eric, the freelancer in Queens. He loves the water. He knows all these stories. So you no longer have to search. Calls come to you.
And by the way, a perfect example is Frank was the first one that took a piece by my student Seth Kugel for the New York Times City section. He was so great to work for. He got a contract at the City section, kept going. He's the frugal traveler, and now he was approached by Norton to write a book about traveling. So it does only benefit you to develop great relationships with your editors. I always say never lie to your editor, your shrink. Okay, so I'll ask one more question and then we'll open it up for a conversation. So everybody's talking and quite honestly, we all know that there's a lot of rejection attached. It can be difficult to break into newspapers and magazines and get a book deal, but I like to focus. I want to be positive, especially it's the new year, and I've actually had, I have 85 students that in the last 10 years that have done books, best publications in the country. In fact, some of them do so well, it's like, congratulations, fuck you. They got a better editor, a way bigger advance. But anyway, so it's totally possible, and I want to talk about the happy stuff. So Judy, out of all the years that you've spent writing, what was the highlight? Like, was it when the New York Times published your piece, or was it when you got a yes from your book? Like, what's been the highlight so far? When you saw the box of them, was that an exciting moment?
Oh my God, unexpected. Sorry, I'm still like panicking because I've worked with half this panel. I'm like, I did that. I made that mistake. Does she hate me? I need to get over all the mistakes I made with these people. Sorry, everyone. What is the highlight moment? That's a really good question. And it's really hard to answer. I think I had it was a very small reading last week, and I think just being in a room and reading what I had written with the people that on my team and had helped me and family members and friends there, and it was real. I was holding this and reading that. I think maybe that moment of was the highlight.
And then the downside the downside you said is your mom and your mother and father are commenting on the book now.
Oh, yes. Yeah. So So it's a family memoir. It's a lot about my mother, and I had been very worried about showing her the book, as I think you might understand. Not only is it so much about her mental illness, but she can be very depressive, even suicidal. And so I was very scared to share the story, and I waited till I was home in Montreal for a few weeks so I could be there in case there was any she had asked me to read it. Otherwise, I don't even know if I would have showed her. And then I finally gave it to her, and then I didn't hear from her for a day or two. I was extremely, I didn't know what to think, and then she called and said, "Judy, I read your book." And I was like, "Oh my God, I can get there in 20 minutes." Like, what? She said, "You know, I find chapter 17, the tone is a little bit off." "Your use of humor and pathos, you're really not evoking the sympathy for the I was like, "Oh my God, you're and I was like, "Oh, she's right." Chapter 17 was off. So she had responded to it as a piece of literature, which is, in fact, as I articulate through the book, we'd always had our strongest connections through art and through literature. So she responded as you, but that was sort of the first stage. Now my parents have the book, and now my mother's been rereading it every day, and has a lot to say. And now, on the one hand, I mean, half the book is about I had such a difficult, distanced relationship with my mother. I never was able to talk to her about things, and here she's read the book, and she has all these things she wants to say. And on the other hand, I'm like, "Oh my God, I can't deal with this now." Like, it's terrifically annoying to be like, all day, "Judy, let's talk about chapter 3 and why that happened." No, but I have to remind myself to put down the laptop and the phone and sit with my mom and listen and talk to her. So yes, that's perhaps another highlight of
that's the book. Based on my own Jewish mother's reaction to my books. One of the rules I say to my students is the first piece that your family hates means that you found your voice.
No, the thing, she doesn't. She likes it. It's so. I
interesting.
Don't know.
Okay, yeah. So Peter, is it? Would you say you just? You're an editor, and you came out with this gorgeous book with your name on it. Was that a highlight of your career so far?
Technically, yeah. I mean, it's so unique for me because I'm publishing articles all the time. I'm working with other people. In this case, I got to write the introduction for the book, help organize the book, and also the satisfaction of knowing that this was a project that started with basically an idea and one article about philosophy that we thought, well, we know this will have merit as human beings. This is a good thing to do. But we didn't really think it would be popular. And it turned out to be so popular and so meaningful to so many people that everyone got together with us to help us produce this. So that's pretty huge. But on a day-to-day basis, really helping people realize their pieces, and not just that, if you take a risk with a writer, you do something different, you push a boundary, and you put it out there, and you finish it in the evening, and then it goes up, and you wake up the next morning, and we really have instant gratification. Sue talks about instant gratification all the time. That's why she loves working with us. We find out immediately whether it's something touched people because they start responding in the thousands. If a writer is not prepared for that or is written for the first time and has that reaction, that's just like a terrific feeling. So that happens, you know, fairly regularly.
Did you tell me that you started at the Times as a copy boy, was it?
Yes.
How long ago was that? Am I allowed to ask?
It was in the 80s when David Bowie was still around.
Yeah. Was it exciting when you were made editor? Was that an exciting moment?
Yeah, because my pay doubled. That was the first thing. I didn't realize I was going to be doing the sort of editing I'm doing now, which is sort of idea-based development of pieces. I was a copy editor, and I learned how to hack stories to pieces really fast, so you could send them to Alabama to the paper down there. So the whole thing was a surprise that it developed like this. So
cool. Rakia, so is it exciting? Has there ever been like a project that you started, that your idea, and then seeing it come to fruition?
Yes. Today was a really exciting day because I signed up this book that it was my idea. I was sitting around and it came to me and I found the writer and we had to negotiate the deal, and it's really been 8 months of pure, like, pulling my hair out and pulling off my fingernails. But today we finally got the deal, and so that was super, super exciting.
Do we get to hear anything about it? Inside information?
No.
Okay, not yet.
But I also wanted to mention that I one of the things that I really value about my job is the mentoring that I'm able to do and the mentoring that I've received. There are not very many people of color in publishing. I don't know why that is, but for some reason it's like getting into publishing can feel like rocket science. And it's really not. So much of it is just relationships and meeting the right people, having access to the Rolodex, and, you know, being in front of someone who's really paying attention to you. And so I just wanted to say briefly that when I started, there were people who looked out for me. And so now I'm in a position where I'm able to look out for younger people. And last week I found myself in very, very, I was in a very special place. I'll leave it at that, I can't say more. But with some very special people. And when I walked in, I knew all of the faces because they had mentored me from when I was what I call a baby editor, you know, 22, 23 years old, just moved to New York. I grew up in Atlanta, if you can't hear the accent. And they just smiled, these big, big grins as they're sitting across from me. And they said, now, where are you again? And I said, I'm at Beacon Press. And I'm like trying not to grin too hard. And they go, what's your title? And I go, senior editor. And they just grin. It was a really, really special moment. So the relationships have been crucial for me.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. And Frank was, because again, like Peter, you were an editor for a long time and then you got your first book. So was that especially exciting?
Yeah, the advance was really exciting because I had two kids about to enter college, so that was nice. But what I was thinking, I think the highlight for me with this book and with little articles, it's just a difference in scale, is when I can see it. You know, this book, this stuff was about 110,000 words, I think, when I wrote it, and I was playing with all different things. It was published at 63,000 words. And I remember the day I said, oh, I see, this is what the book is. It's like the fog parted, you know, and you could see the structure. And it's exactly the same uplifting feeling when you edit an essay or what Judy was saying, you know, about she wrote all this stuff and then she realized the book was about hoarding, that was the nugget of her book, and it all flowed from there, and her daughter. I mean, I think that's the creative process. That's like the golden moment where you see, you know, what your article or your essay is. And if you're a writer, that's got to be, or an editor too, because it doesn't matter whether I edit a piece and see it or whether I write a piece and see it. It's the same thing. That to me is like the best thing, you know, about what we all do.
Also, I remember, I love your story where you said, I think you went to law school, and I love, there's a part in your book about like the first day that you're working at the New York Times. So is that, could you talk a little bit about how did you go from law school to being an editor?
Well, I always wanted to be a writer. I went to law school because I wanted to learn about the law so I could write about the law and then write about other things. So that's why I went to law school. But on my first day, it was in April 1993, and I knew nothing. I was less than naive. And in the middle of the afternoon, as I'm trying to figure out how the computer works and where the pencils are, these waitresses and waiters come in with carts of champagne, and I'm saying, whoa, this is the summit of American journalism. But what was happening, of course, is that it was the day the Pulitzer Prizes were announced, and so the champagne is delivered to the newsroom and everyone's happy. So it was a learning curve from that moment on.
Great.
But I'm glad I did that instead of the biggest decision, the best decision I ever made in my life, as I tell everyone who is listening, cares to listen, was when I decided not, after having gone to law school, not to practice law. Not that being a lawyer is bad, it was bad for me, because I knew that I loved to write and edit and deal with words, and so that's what I, you know, ended up doing. But if you have to do something else to make your bread and butter, do that, but keep writing too. You know, write on the side a few hours a week. If you really love writing, you will.
Yeah, it's interesting. One of my students, Judy Alboa, wrote a great book called One Person, Multiple Career, and she says the wave of the future is that people are going to have a couple things that they do, and I'm in a section of people who write by day but teach by night. Right. But there's like a banker who's a pastry chef on weekends. And I think that's just such a great, it's so smart, especially if you want to live in a big city like New York. So, you know, my husband and I both do that for years now. So we teach to pay the bills, and then we get to write whatever we want. And I know lots of people that have been able to combine, you know, editing with writing. I think that's, yeah, I think that's really smart. Alia, was it exciting for you to see poets and writers and have your picture and be, was that fun?
I wouldn't say that. I mean, that was fine. It's for me, it's this whole thing. Like, it's when you're an agent, I think, at least for me, it's not about me. Like,
okay.
You know, I'm here because Judy's here. So, and I'm just sort of thinking about highlights. Like, I mean, it's for me, it's always about my writers and what happens with them. I'm not a writer. So, and it, almost every day something exciting happens. So it's even hard to think like what was the most exciting thing, because it's, I love my job so much, and every day something good happens for one of my writers, or something interesting comes in. It's never, ever boring. But to think about highlights, I just want to talk about a highlight with Judy, because she's here, and when I'm with my, whatever writer I'm with, I want to talk about them.
Good.
So I think this is very representative of what's exciting about my job, and also what an agent sort of, how an agent experiences their writer. So when you're the writer, you're very neurotic about your book, and you're very worried about how things will come about. But with you're the agent, of course you're worried too, but you can't show how worried you are, and you're less worried. You're less worried than the author. And Judy had this reading, her first reading, and she was so worried about this reading. And she was worried about this reading because it was on the Upper East Side. And she's like, nobody's going to come. And she was acting like the reading was in Yonkers. No offense to anybody from Yonkers. People who live in downtown Manhattan are going to come to your reading on the Upper East Side. It's not that hard to get there. And there was this like sweet anxiety and modesty about it. She's like, I don't know. It's the Upper East Side. Like, and I had the wisdom of the perspective of seeing many writers publish their books and seeing that they, that their friends will come out, but also knowing that Judy's book is great and that she has been promoting her book in many ways in her work for years and has these amazing relationships. I knew that people would come to the reading. I just didn't know how many. So I was like, I'm gonna go to this reading. It's gonna be crowded. It's gonna be fine. And I was looking forward to that moment. So I was a little late, and I'm pulling up to the bookstore on the Upper East Side, thinking, why did I tell her to have this on the Upper East Side? This is so far from my house. And I pull, and there are people outside of the bookstore. I can't get into the bookstore. The reading was so crowded that there was like a line around the block, literally. People are like walking their dogs past the bookstore being like, who is at this bookstore? Her friends are shouting, this amazing book is being published. I'm like, I'm the agent, can I get in? They're like, no. They would, and I tried to pull that card, and they were like, no. And it was so exciting. That was probably my most exciting moment with Judy, is that I knew how worried she was, and I knew without even seeing her face how relieved she would be, and that I was a part of making this moment happen. And then I think part of my job, and I guess this is part of the job for the publishing professionals who help the books along, is it's kind of being the voice of reason and then getting a little bit of that sparkly magic when the good stuff happens.
Great. Fantastic. Wayne, is it more exciting when your book came out, because you have the editor and the writer world?
It's different. It's better. It's different. I'll be honest. I take a lot of pride in working with writers as an editor, and I'm thrilled when I can get a piece into shape and really help a writer express herself better and really get a point home. I love that. And sometimes it takes one revision, almost never. Sometimes it takes months, and sometimes it takes crying. Sometimes the person crying is me. But I'm really proud when that happens. And as an editor, or as an agent, I think sometimes we're the invisible people behind the scenes, and I'm thrilled to let the writer get all the acclaim, and that's great. Here's the difference. It's not just because this book has my name on it, although that's part of it. Part of it is that Tablet, or before this I worked at The Forward, before that Billboard, before that The Blade, those are publications. They come out every day or every week, and if your piece isn't in it today, someone else's piece is. It comes out every day, and it's not a piece I edited, it's a piece someone else edited. It comes out every day, and people read it every day or every week, I hope, and that will continue. With a novel, no one's waiting for your novel. There is no pull from the world pulling a novel out of you. No one's waiting for it. No one's waiting for your publication date. No agent is going, if only Wayne would send in a manuscript, I'd be sure to sign it. No one is saying that. No bookstore is saying, there's an empty spot on the shelf. If only you would write a novel, I'd put it right here. So to write a novel is an act of sheer will and determination and perseverance and insanity. Those are all synonyms. And it's also collaborative, but yes, my name's on it. And what it means is that to get a novel out into the market takes an inordinate amount of tenacity. And to open that box when it first comes from the printer is whatever your favorite drug is, that's what it's like, except it's better. And then, for me, I love being in front of a room talking, so it gives me an excuse to get in front of a room and talk, which I'm thrilled to do, and some writers hate, but I love, because I'm somewhat insane. And to be able to put out, look, this newest novel is actually a novella. The world is certainly not waiting for a novella. They're certainly not waiting for a novella about a middle-aged gay man's sex life. The world is not waiting for that. But here it is. And the only thing better than seeing that box from your publisher is seeing it on a shelf in a bookstore. And the only thing better than that is accidentally, coincidentally, running into someone who has your book in your hand. And the first time it happened, I was in Provincetown, and there was someone walking down the street who had my first novel in his hand, Hard. And I just was staring at him, and he said, "What?" I said, "That's my book." And he said, "No, it isn't. I just bought it." I said, "No, turn it over." And he went, "Oh my God, it is you." And that's when I had, inside my brain, the biggest orgasm of my life.
It's funny because my husband's still mad at me because when I first saw my book across the street at a bookstore window, I blurted out, "This is the best moment of my life." And he was like, not our wedding? And I was like, oh, one of the best. Lauren, did you have that same feeling when your first book came out? Was that the most exciting moment?
I can't live up to the brain orgasm. No, but probably my book sold. I was so young. That's the biggest thing that I think of when I think of, you know, life regrets, and like I was sort of a total naive idiot. Just wrote this book literally in the dark, 5 to 7 in the morning, and it sold, and I didn't really get at the time what a big deal it was. Now I look back on it with such love and appreciation and regret for not having got it at the time. I will say one of the highlights is actually a low light, in that I wrote a book much more recently, that a novel that I worked really hard on and didn't sell, and that was so devastating. But also, as an editor and someone who now really works with writers, I just feel like this didn't prepare me as much for, I don't know, getting in the corner of somebody who's working so hard, as having been through that as well. And I co-wrote this book and a few other books with a co-writer, and when I'm editing, I pretty much am co-writing with my writers now. So
I had my novel, first novel that I wrote, took 13 years from the time I started till the time it finished, and many incarnations. And so instead of a book launch, we gave it a book mitzvah. And I had everybody who helped me, every ghost editor who helped me rewrite. And by the way, like a whole generation of editors who had rejected it had like died out. And then I found a 24-year-old who like thought she discovered me. So don't give up just because it didn't sell yet. Just,
well, you know,
right. Yeah. Revise. Okay. We have time for some questions. Yes.
So let's say I submit an article with Times, and now I'm waiting to hear back. How long should I wait before I send it someplace?
Okay, good question. So she wants to know, if she sends an article to the New York Times, how long should she wait before she sends it elsewhere? I would say, just from my own knowledge, that every section of the time is different. For example, the New York Times Modern Love editor says, give me 3 or 4 months. The op-ed pages, I think, are faster.
Yeah, and also depends on whether it's a time-sensitive piece or not, or it has eternal appeal. You know, if you send something, I can just tell you, to me, if you sent something to me or someone in my department and you followed up and it wasn't time-sensitive, a week to 2 weeks later with a polite follow-up is fine. We might say, I won't really get to it for another 2 or 3 weeks. Try again later. But the whole idea of responding one-to-one with writers is a challenge now because there are so many. Some things get lost in the shuffle. That's like, I'm a little ashamed to say, but it happens. But polite follow-ups are fine.
And by the way, you know, one of the reasons why you make a piece timely is because they, you know, they get back to you quicker. So for example, if somebody wants to write if someone's working on a piece and they're going to send it out tomorrow, Valentine's Day, and you say to an editor, I have a piece for Valentine's Day, and I put that in the subject heading, and the chances are they'll get back to you and say, oh, I already have my Valentine's Day piece, or, oh, let me take a look at this. So being timely, I think, is maybe, especially with an op-ed, that could be a good thing. Frank, do you remember how long it would take you in the city section to get back to people?
Well, the same variable that Peter just spoke about was true, you know, time-sensitive stuff. Sometimes we'd have our galleys for that week's issue, and if it were really timely and we had to get it in, we'd tear it up and we'd get back to the person like immediately. I think this is a very difficult question for writers because there are editors who don't get back to you ever. And so I'm not sure. I mean, a lot of people do different things. I mean, one thing I've heard is that people will say in the first letter, if I don't hear back from you in 2 weeks or in 10 days, I'll assume you're not interested, rather than sending a follow-up that also goes unanswered. It's a difficult thing, and fairness to writers has to be thought about a lot. I mean, I do know some people who say, you know, when I have a story that I want to sell to the Times, I'm going to send it to them. I'm not going to send it anywhere else because I want to get a clip from the Times. But if that doesn't work and I send it to 4 other publications, you know, I can admit it in the letter and say that, but maybe they won't read it. Or I cannot say anything and then just take my chances that, you know, 2 of them won't buy it simultaneously and hope that one does. I don't really know, but I mean, I think I know it's a huge problem out there.
By the way,
non-responsive editors.
But this is also why writing groups and classes and events like this and seminars, because if you have a community of writers, like for example, if I send a piece to the Times, I'll just say to someone in my writing group, you wrote for them, how long did they take to get back to you? You know, or, oh, I'm going to say, oh, Judy Batalion gave me your name. You know, so there's ways if you connect with other writers and editors that you could find out more information. Lauren, I would think for a monthly magazine, it could be way longer. Like people, that when I write for monthlies, it could be 3 months because right now a monthly magazine might be closing April or May. Right?
Yes, but I'm, can you hear me? Nope. You are, hello? Sorry, no.
Project.
I will say I'm not organized enough where I would expect to write. If I don't respond to something immediately, it's very unlikely unless it's a pitch by somebody who I have a really close relationship with or I'm already really passionate about that I am gonna, in so many places, and they are always rare that I'll remember, oh, there was that place that someone said on November 3rd. So I someone reminding me, assuming that, not that I've been deliberating over the pitch that came in 15 minutes ago, but more, I'm sure it slipped out of sight, but
I think, you know, if you follow up a few times very politely and you don't hear, then I think you send it elsewhere. I think the mistake is that people right away send to 5 editors, which I don't think is cool. There was another question right there? Yes. Yes. No, she's not going to read tonight. We're just doing a talk tonight, but she'll do some more readings. We'll post them on the on her website. Yes.
You mentioned before, and I'd love to ask Alia, the protocol for multiple submissions for an agent. Of course, really, really long, hard proposal, and they take a while to read. Do you
you state it's multiple, is it ever an incentive to the agent when you say, I really want you, this is an exclusive?
Of course. It's definitely an incentive if you say it's an exclusive and they really want you, especially if they're specific about it. I don't know if this is on, but hopefully you can hear me.
Yes.
If it's multiple, for agents, usually it's okay if you just say that. And then I've had this happen a couple times where if it's multiple, if someone offers you representation, let the agent know immediately. And then I'll read very, very quickly. I'm quick, but I'm not that quick, but I'll be quicker, and most people are quicker if they hear that you have an offer.
Great. Another question over there? Yes. Yes.
First of all, thank you all so much for being here. It's so helpful. This question is mostly for Alia, but I'm not here for anyone. So for those of us out here who've written novels or fiction, do you recommend sending out excerpts or chapters for publication in literary magazines in the hopes of then getting the full work published?
Yes.
Yeah.
Good.
No reason not. No,
why not?
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Do you have a question? Yes.
Does the New York Times review self-published properties? No?
Other questions? Yeah, no, Publishers Weekly does now, but not the New York Times. Yes.
I'm sort of in a similar camp. I have a novel manuscript that I'm querying agents right now. My question is, how quick do I get into the actual query piece? I've done my research with agents, hey, you published XYZ book, and I kind of feel like a little sycophantic going in, and I'm wondering, are they sitting there rolling their eyes like, all right, this guy read a couple book jackets, trying to kiss my ass.
Hopefully you read more than the back of the book jacket. I think that, I mean, it's not about, the query is not about us, but I think like one, two sentences about why you're querying that agent, and then you, I think that's a nice balance. It shouldn't be sycophantic. It shouldn't be just like this person threw a bunch of names there. I think if it's...
Exactly.
Like, I'd rather one sentence that says why you liked a particular book and then how your book is like that than five shout-outs.
Oh, by the way, I saw you at the Strand bookstore and I love the way you talked about your author and it made me wish you were my agent. That's sincere.
Right, yeah.
Right? So you could say something sincere.
Sincere.
You're going to get 100 of those tomorrow. Okay, some final questions. Lisa.
Hi. Hey, this question is for Judy, and it speaks to something you talked about before, and it's basically, there are other books about borders, so how did you sort of differentiate this? What was your sort of crystal moment of, well, there's another thing about borders, but this is more of like a...
Right, so there are a few books about hoarder. Is this working?
Yeah, it works.
Hello. Okay, so the difference in my story was that it was a generational story, and it was a story about how not only hoarding had impacted me, but how I was, my grandmother was also a hoarder, and how I was gonna try to switch that family dynamic to the next generation. And so finding that structure, that unique point, that was like an aha moment, and I think that's what helped the sell as well.
Okay, we have time for one or two more questions. Jane?
Mr. Catapano, do you want to receive fishes all parts of the
op-ed? Oh, good question. Yeah, no, he doesn't.
Me, personally?
Which one do you do?
Right now, I'm just working with the stone. I don't have a separate project again until probably the spring.
But people could pitch you a regular op-ed piece.
You can pitch a regular op-ed because I know so little about so many things. I will usually send it to somebody who knows. Not really, no.
Final question here? Yes.
This for non-fiction writers and proposals, essentially, if you'd like to identify no dues for proposals for non-fiction writers.
Say that again?
Journalists are non-fiction writers.
Yes.
On their proposals, what are the worst mistakes that they should not make, or if you have examples of
What are the worst things that that you see in nonfiction proposals?
I think, well, first of all, it's really obvious that some people have Googled how to do a book proposal. Terrible idea. And then the book proposal reads like a PowerPoint presentation. There's a lot of stuff that is like, they hear marketing, writer hears marketing's important, and it just reads like marketing spiel. Instead of realizing that the person reading your book proposal will first be an agent, and then be someone who is a reader. So I think the whole proposal is reads engagingly, and not like PowerPoint presentation with bullet points and marketing spiel. I think that's really important. Every moment should be well written. Even the comp title section should be well written. And I would say too that you see a lot of is when people talk about the market for their book, they talk about the popularity of a particular subject. For example, you know, if it's a book about drugs, how many people do drugs? And which is a very vague example. But I think that when publishers and agents think about books, they don't think about the popularity of just the subject in general, but the kind of readership that book will find. So really, when you talk about the marketing of your book and how you're imagining the book and its readership, think about it in terms of other books. Instead of like, I Googled this and there are X amount of drug addicts in the world. Well, no. Like, talk about that. There's a lot of, like you said, a lot of books about addiction and recovery. How is your book part of this world of books about addiction and recovery? You're entering in a conversation among other books. That's my short answer.
That's great. And by the way, I'm going to give out my cards, and if anybody wants to email me any questions, there are many, I could recommend many great writing teachers, many great ghost editors. Frank is fantastic. There's other ghost editors who specialize in fiction or nonfiction proposals or essays or articles. So I would highly recommend not finishing a project at 3 a.m, deciding it's brilliant and emailing it, but to either take a class, take a seminar, spend some time with a ghost editor, which has been the way that that I got very lucky doing it. And actually Judy also had took a class, used ghost editors, did a writing workshop, so it was a whole process. Anyway, I wanted to thank everybody for coming tonight, and I especially wanted to thank this amazing panel, and I wanted to thank the Strand Bookstore, so you guys buy some books and keep this amazing institution in business. We have all our books over there, so all the authors are going to be signing books, and we're going to and we have some cards here. And thank you again, and especially congratulations to Judy Batalion on the most beautiful memoir, White Walls.